the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses have risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Let's sing together the hymn number 27, based on that psalm. Hymn number 27, the Lord, my Saviour, is my light.
Thank you. audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available in the entrance vestibule. Today's ministry will be available after this evening service, and our magazine Sword and Trowel will also be obtained. During this week, our prayer meeting is on Monday evening at 7:30. Our Bible study is on Wednesday evening, when the preacher will be our pastor. We will continue with studies in the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 4, the message of King Nebuchadnezzar's madness. This service begins at 7:30.
turning today to Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8 and verse 11. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. And I'm considering today in a single study the process of sanctification. And we recently completed a series of studies, and before we embark on another, it gives us an opportunity to look at some single issues. Process of sanctification, just an overview. Now, we were considering last week correcting spiritual coldness, so it's appropriate to look at these verses in Romans 8 to see the apostles' inspired teaching on the way of sanctification. Well, sanctification, first of all, begins with salvation. Obviously, without conversion to Christ, without salvation, there can be no sanctification, no improvement in life, no advance in godliness and holiness. It would seem to be obvious, but it's necessary for the Apostle Paul to emphasize this, and I go back therefore to verse 3, and we shall look at consecutive verses as we consider this first heading, that sanctification begins essentially with salvation. Verse 3, the Apostle says, for the law, that is the Ten Commandments, and not just the Ten Commandments, but the exposition of the Ten Commandments provided by Moses. And remember the commandments, the Ten Commandments, each one of them is an indication of a whole world of deeds and righteousness. You look at the negative commandments, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, but you must always remember, which we do, that each commandment is only the head of a family of sins. The commandment not to kill, not to murder, is the head of a whole family of murder sins, which includes hatred, murdering of people's freedom and liberty and self-respect and happiness and so on. The head of the family is the taking of life, but the taking of all other things ranks under them. And in each negative commandment, we have to consider the opposite positive virtue. So it's not enough not to kill, not to hate, and not to deprive people of happiness and liberty and so on. We have to be givers of these things. And so when you consider this, the commandments, as Moses in the Old Testament proceeds to explain them and expound them, are very full. They are but a summary of a whole field of reasonable righteousness which God requires of us. The law is wonderful. It's intricate. Or if it could be obeyed, what a society we would live in. What people we would be. But there's something wrong with the law. It's not wrong in itself. It's perfect. It's the perfect scheme of righteousness. It's beautiful. It describes a perfect person, a perfect society, if only it could be accomplished. But there is a fatal weakness. Now, the weakness actually isn't in the law, but it is in a sense. And this is how the Apostle explains it. For what, verse 3, chapter 8, for what the law could not do, for all its wonder and its perfection and its high standard, for what the law could not do in that it was weak, a fatal weakness, not an error, but a weakness through the flesh. That's the trouble. After all, the weakness isn't in the law, it's in us. Because the law requires willing compliance. The law requires obedience. And if the people weakness and my insignificance and my corruption. And one man once said to me, I felt like a snail. And that's the truth, dear friends. But this isn't sent to condemn. It's to awaken, to find the mercy of Christ. They that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. They can do good things. They can live after the flesh, ye shall die. You can't be truly converted. If all your mind and your hopes and your aspirations and your desires are for the here and now, of course you've got to give some concern to the here and now. You've got to live a proper life and provide for yourself and your family and your home and your clothing and your sustenance and so on. Of course, everybody's got to give time to the here and now. But all your time isn't there. If you live after the flesh, totally devoted to the here and now, and found in gains of pleasure and sin, well then it means you're not converted, says the apostle. You shall die. But, verse 13, if ye through the Spirit, by the enabling power of the Spirit, do mortify, put to death, the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Proves you're a Christian, truly converted. Well, dear friends, I'd like to move on. We won't complete our message this morning to the second heading, and that is that sanctification, improvement in holiness is progressive through life. I deal with this only briefly. If you live after the flesh, you shall die. But it's progressive. I go back to chapter 7, very briefly in this, in chapter 7 and verse 14. Now, the Apostle Paul is undoubtedly describing himself as a Christian man. And here he shows how there is an ongoing battle against sin. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, he says, sold under sin. That's chapter 7, verse 14. Those words are so strong that many people say, no, no, the apostle must be describing himself before he was converted. He's speaking of himself as he used to be, surely, before his conversion. But he isn't. When you study the passage carefully, he's speaking of himself as a converted man, as an apostle. Now, mark you, the apostle's standards for himself are very high. He is so distressed at his sin. We would, if we had the privilege of living alongside the Apostle Paul in his day, I dare say we'd be very hard put to find any blemishes in him. But in his mind, he was still a sinner and still struggling, and the process was still going on. That's how he puts it. We know that the law is spiritual, it's good. But I am carnal, sold under sin. I still have my old sin nature within me, he seems to say. And then there's that very depressing passage, depressing on the surface, if we fail to read it all the way through, verse 15 of chapter 7. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not, but what I hate, that do I. Don't read too much into this. The apostle isn't saying he's a total wreck and failure. From his high standard imposed upon himself, he laments his weakness and failure, which continues until we die. But then there are the verses that follow, verse 18, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, he refers to just make a suggestion. The apostle says, I'm going out to preach. I'm sick. I'm not well. The people are hostile. Last time I preached in this place, they threw stones and rocks at me. But I must go for their soul's sake. I'm going out to preach. And another voice within him would say, don't go. It's not reasonable they should treat you in that way. And besides, you're sick. And he's strongly tempted from within himself to give up that task and that work. which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. For they